Just close your eyes where you are. Your expectation today. I will meet you at the point of your need. And just to prove a point, I'll even go further to what you were not expecting. Today you will know that being a Christian is living a supernatural life. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Just ask you, considering the words that Lawrence has spoken, I know for some of you they're still sinking in your spirit, but just tell God something about them. Tell God you're going to be obedient and you're going to follow them, because there's something that God wants to communicate concerning the words that were just spoken. Just silently make a prayer. Thank you, Lord, for we are going to be obedient to your word. We are going to be men of prayer. And as we do that, we are going to walk in the miraculous. Oh, thank you. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for this wonderful gathering. We pray that you may start with us and end with us. And at the end of it all, we promise to give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the criticism. In the name of the Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, we have to understand by now, all of you who are here, that you are part of the word empowerment movement. And may I just take this honor to also explain further that we are not miracle empowerment. Now, there's a reason why we are one and not the other. There's a scriptural principle that backs this statement. I'm not saying them from without. When you read the book of John chapter 14, Jesus Christ said, "The words that I say, I do not say them myself. But the Father that lives in me does the works." Now, if you look at that scripture grammatically, if you've done English before, or if you are a lover of academics, you realize that it's not correct. How come the man was talking about words, and then he changes and he starts talking about the works? He says, "The words that I speak are not mine, but the Father that lives in me doeth the works that you see." If we are supposed to state it correctly, he was supposed to say, "The words that I speak are not mine, but the Father who lives in me makes me say the words that I say." But that's not a mistake, and it is not there to make English difficult from the KJV. It's not there for decoration. A point was communicated. When you read it from the Message Bible, it says, the words that I speak are not mine, but when I speak them, the Father that is in me transforms every word into a divine act. You see, words are the ones in the spiritual realm that produce divine acts. The Bible tells us, "And God said, let there be, and there was, and he said, this is good." This is why we tell you to understand the power of words. It's one of the principal doctrines, I can say. It's one of the principal pillars of the Christian faith. Words. 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 Words produce miracles. Either dark miracles or bright ones. Words. Even guys, the mom of our goal. Tamam fakoo. Fakoo. Tamam. 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 Tamam certain people abachikunile ngabako bafati iwe dawakaina mkuno they were going to know but just those words that they spoken to the person was angry by the good now for the god why words the tongue has got power over life and death and they that love it shall fruit shall eat the fruit thereof that statement is neutral it applies to both Christians and non-Christians and at one point I kept asking God why is it that everywhere in your word you keep telling us to use words everywhere you read the Bible almost every book says something about words and God took me to Genesis chapter 1 verses 26 and he said then I said let me create man in my own image and likeness again I'm here to tell you ladies and gentlemen that those words image and likeness are not there for decor they are not there to make it look nice and that God is a man full of speech but they communicate a point we were not only made in the image of God but we were also made in his likeness to be made in his image is to be like him in form God is a spirit we are also spirit God has got a head we also have a head he's got hands we also have hands that image that's image but likeness means we take after his likeness I would speak a lot about his likeness but in one way we can relate to God according to likeness is words whatever God created he said let there be and it was you've been made in that likeness when you understand this thing you mature in your Christian faith I know even pagans use this principle and sometimes most of the time it works to their disadvantage but what more you who is filled with the word of God this is why we are called word empowerment amen
amen
okay I'm going to try to calm down okay glory to God hallelujah
amen
oh, praise
God
this morning I'm here on a special assignment. I just want to speak a few words concerning the next session we're going to get into because as you speak words and as you worship God in the next session, so much is going to start happening because there's a grace in this place. There's a grace upon this movement. And as we get into the next segment, expectations are going to be met. Amen. So I'm trying to prepare you for that segment. Genesis chapter 11 verse 1. I'm going to read from the Amplified Version and I'll go before you because I think I'm a good reader. And the whole earth was of one language and of one accent and mode of expression. And as they journeyed eastwards, they found a plain valley in the land of Shinar and they settled and dwelt there. And they said one to the other, come, let us make bricks and burn them thoroughly. So they had brick for stone, and slime that is bitumen for mortar. 4. And they said, come, let us build a city and a tower whose top reaches into the sky. And let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered over the whole earth. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the sons of men had built. And the Lord said, behold, they are one people, and they have all one language. And this is only the beginning of what they will do. And now nothing they have imagined they can do will be impossible for them. Come, let us go down there and confound them. Let's mix them up and confuse their language. That they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord scattered them abroad from that place upon the face of the whole earth. And they gave up building the city. Now, when you read this scripture, what comes into your mind? Some questions that came, maybe it might not come to your mind, but some questions that came into my mind was, why? Why did God mix them up? Why did he scatter them? Now, if you've read it before, I'm sure some of you have come to think, when you read the context of the scripture, you think maybe it's because God was scared. They were going to find him since they wanted to build a city that was going to reach the heavens. So they are going to find out where he stays. But again, when you look at how much Sans has discovered, you get to think, okay, this note is really a stupid idea, because they would have just ended in space and maybe they would have died because there's no oxygen there. So what does the Bible say? Why did God stop them? Why? Tell your neighbor, the purpose of God shall stand. I'm going to show you why God messed up their language. When you read Genesis chapter 1, verses 28, originally God's intention for the creation of man was so that man would replenish the earth, that he would fill it, that man would multiply, that the earth would be filled. Man was only created at one place that is known as the Garden of Eden. But God's original purpose, God's original intent was that man would fill up the whole earth. But look at verse 6. I'll read it. It says, I'll read verse 4. It says, and they said, come, let us build us a city and a tower whose top reaches into the sky, and let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered over the whole earth. You see that? They didn't want to scatter over the whole earth, because God said, go and multiply and fill the earth. So there was a clash of purposes. There was a purpose of man and there was a purpose of God. God's original intent shall stand. And this intent of man was going to succeed for one reason. That meant God said, guys, our boys are Katawabarika. They will do whatever they want. I mean, God had to come down from the throne and come. Oh my goodness. Man can be so complex. He had to be scattered. The reason why he was going to succeed is in verse 6, and that's where I'm going to dwell for some time. The Bible says, and the Lord said, behold, they are one people, and they have all one language. And this is only the beginning of what they will do. And now nothing they have imagined they can do will be impossible for them. Why? Because they had one voice. They had one language. They had one mode of communication. And if you stand like that, whatever you plan to do shall not fail. Have you realized Jesus Christ said, where two or three are gathered in my name and they agree upon anything on this earth, it shall be done for them. You see, there's a reason why he didn't say where one agrees with himself. Yes, we can agree, we can pray with the Holy Spirit, but there's just a special grace when men come together and they decide to agree on a matter in the name of the Lord Jesus. Now, the scripture that I've read to you, they actually perverted the principle. This is why sometimes even terrorist groups are difficult to catch, because maybe they use one language. And men have perverted this principle. People have succeeded in business in the wrong way because they've decided to team up. And so they're successful in what they're doing. And the world is now at stake. The world is polluted. The blood of men that has been spilled because men conspired to do evil things is crying out. The land is polluted, and diseases of all manners of kinds are coming up. Why? Because men are selfish and they are coming together for a wrong motive and they are succeeding. Us Christians don't want to come together to church to pray.
Whoa.
It's time we took back our principles and use them for the better. If we have one language, I'm telling you, we're going to shake this country. Second Chronicles chapter 5, verse 11 to 14. You can write it down. I'm going to go before you. And it came to pass when the priests were come out of the holy place, also the Levites, which were the singers of all them of Asaph, of Haman, of Jeduthun, with their sons and their brethren, being arrayed in white linen, having cymbals and psalteries and harps, stood at the east end of the altar, and with them 120 priests, sounding with trumpets. 120 priests. Have you observed how God was so specific with details of the Old Testament? Why not 160? Why 120? Why not 2? Why 120? Never, God is deep.
God is deep.
Yeah, I thought so too. It came even to pass as trumpets and singers were as one to make one sound to be heard in praising and thanking the Lord. And when they lifted up their voice, if you notice, it does not say voices, it said their voice. You say, but this one was saying Aniwama, this one was saying Hallelujah. Yes, but God heard one voice, that's why he's God. And this is what they said. They praised the Lord, saying, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. That then the house was filled with a cloud, even the house of the Lord. Glory to God. So the priest stood. The priest, rather, could not stand to minister by reason of the cloud. For the glory of the Lord had filled the house of God. Now we know by now that the glory of God, if you don't know how to explain it, the glory of God is the Holy Spirit. For the Bible tells us in Romans chapter 6 verse 4 that Jesus was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father. And in chapter 8 verse 11 it tells us that if that same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead, so we say the glory of God. In the Old Testament they could not understand it, they only saw a cloud. Yes, he manifested in that form. But the Spirit of the Lord had come. And there was a sign that the Spirit of the Lord had come, there was cloud in the place. Why? Because the people as one voice, as one with one language, they lifted up their voice and they praised the Lord. And the Lord had no choice but to come and inhabit the praises of his children. Amen. Oh glory, this is what is going to happen soon. This is why I've titled my sermon the corporate anointing. That's one of the greatest forms of the anointing that we've ever not understood. Yes, you are anointed as an individual, but there's also a point where you come together as believers and you sit down and God begins to give grace that we have never encountered before. This is why in this time we are going to praise God, we are going to bow down and we are going to worship him. And I'm telling you, you can mark this, some of you are going to start getting healed as you worship God. Some of your needs are going to start being met as you worship God. You will need nobody to come and lay hands on you. But the glory of the Lord God Jehovah and his perambulating presence is going to touch you where you are. Psalm 133 tells us that behold how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious ointment upon the head that ran down upon the beard, even Aaron's beard, that went down to the skirts of his garments, as the dew of Hermon, and as the dew that descends upon Mount Zion, for the Lord commanded the blessing, even life forevermore. When they come together. Oh my goodness. Sometimes I'm reading this scripture and I get to realize, guys, David did understand some of the things he used to talk about. But that's what happens when you're speaking by the Spirit of God. You don't have to understand everything. You just have to say it, and it will work for you good. Because when you read this scripture, it's talking about the body of Christ. It's using Aaron as a type. So the ointment, or the anointing, moves from the head. That is the Lord Jesus, who is the head of the church. And then it starts coming down even to those that God has called. Okay? That's why you should have respect for those who feed you on the word of God. Don't always excel them. Yes, you can have good relationships with them, but they can bless you. The Lord told me just to do this at that point. So the anointing comes from the Lord Jesus. It comes upon the pastor. This is why when your pastor buys a good car, when your pastor builds a house, you should celebrate, because that same anointing is coming from the pastor and it is coming from you. Starts coming and because they're together, it touches everybody.
Imagine if some other parts are not agreeing their way. Yes, the anointing will come on the pastor will be blessed in a certain way, but those that do not agree with him shall not be blessed. They shall keep walking on their feet. But anyway, God is also gracious. Their shoes will never finish. You see, we are all Christians. But the thing is, you never bought a car because you disagreed when your pastor bought it. Because they are together, because they have got one spirit and they've got one voice, and the anointing of the Lord flows upon everybody. Today it's gonna flow.
Amen.
Like milk. I don't know what that means, but it sounds nice. It's gonna flow like milk. Acts chapter 4, verse 24. And when they heard that, they lifted up their voice to God with one accord. They lifted up their voice to God. Have you realized that word, that voice business, that one voice thing is coming up again?
Uh-huh.
I hope I thought so too. Okay. And saying, Lord, thou art God, which has made heaven and earth and the sea and all that is in them. 31.
Glorious. You hacked into my system.
And when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled together, and they were filled with the Holy Ghost, and the place was shaken.
Mm-hmm.
And they spoke the word of God with boldness. That sounds like word of God.
Uh-huh.
It says the place is, guys, open. When people shake and therefore, wait until places begin to shake. DK, are you ready? Oh my goodness. Start shaking. The Bible says, and as they sang praises to God, Paul and Silas in prison, it says, then there came an earthquake. It even shook the foundations of the earth. It was not just the earthquake that shook the walls, but it even shook the foundations of the earth. Why? Because they were singing praise. They were worshiping God with one accord. You guys, do you understand that the highest form of anointing in the body of Christ is when you gather together as believers? I'm telling you, it's so dangerous. I want you to start singing praises to God. The atmosphere is charged.